It's not a matter of if, but when. This quote has been said more times by tech enthusiasts than bytes has a terabyte, mostly referring to how all storage devices will, inevitably, one day, stop working. I've had a lot of computers throughout the years, most of them with barely any disk space available, resulting in me having continuous battles to just have a little bit more free space. Almost 2 years ago, I bought myself my first decent computer, and after years of struggling with 300 gigabytes, I seized the opportunity to grab a 4 terabyte hard disk drive. Thing is, and if you have gone through a similar situation, I'm sure you can relate, this didn't stop my storage problems, it just left me more room to neglect my files organization. Albeit this allowed me to chill out for a bit, this came with another problem, data loss. I'm sure you know as well as I do that 4 terabytes is a lot of storage. Hence, a lot of important files would be lost if anything were to occur to this drive. Even if my disk is still in good condition, I always have in the back of my mind the what if. So, to put an end to that, I decided to stop procrastinating my need for a NAS. A NAS, also known as network attached storage, acts like a box of data where you can save, share, or access files from any device. Kind of like your own Google Cloud, but without a multi-billionaire company spying on your files. I love DIY projects, so instead of buying a branded NAS, I decided to make my own using a Raspberry Pi 4. This thing is like a pocket computer, so it can do everything that a regular computer can do, like powering this pair of 3 terabyte hard disk drives that I will use for storage. Well, not actually, this thing has the brains of a computer, but not nearly the power required to continuously run more than one pair of drives. So we will also need these USB to SATA adapters. That way we can easily plug disks to a power plug and get enough electricity to power them. Still, they have to communicate with our Raspberry Pi, otherwise it would be as if we had 2 hands, but no arms to make use of them. We also need a vessel to carry and keep our structure secured, so I made sure to get some resin printed parts for this purpose, as well as a micro SD card to store our data. You might be wondering if this would be possible with laptop drives, aka 2.5 inch drives, and the answer would be that yes, but you have to do some tweaking. See, the problem with having a mini computer the size of our hands is that it also has the fraction of the power that a real computer could provide to its components, in this case, our storage. 2.5 inch drives typically need 6 watts, so connecting it to a powered USB hub that supports these outputs should be enough. This USB hub with 7 ports has 5 volts and 3 amperes, which would mean it has 15 watts of power. So theoretically, it could power up to 2 drives under ideal conditions. On the other hand, this USB hub with also 7 ports has 12 volts and 3 amperes, which if we do the math, would let us power up to 6 drives, as it has enough capacity to sufficiently power each of the storage devices, though we will need an extra slot to power up our Raspberry Pi from this same device, as this hub will be connected to a power plug as to supply enough power for all of our equipment. So with this setup, you could use 5 different 2.5 inch drives. 3.5 inch drives have different power needs, as they were designed to be inside of a whole computer instead of just a laptop, so they need more power. They consume 6 to 12 watts on average and crucially require both 5 and 12 volts power lines. Standard USB hubs typically lack the sufficient wattage for these drives, so if we decide to go bigger, we will need an additional power plug to connect our disks, independently from the USB hub, that we will still need as to let them communicate with our NAS. So, in summary, 2.5 inch drives require 6 watts and can be powered solely by an USB hub, as long as we pick a powerful one. 3.5 inch drives require both 6 to 12 watts and both 5 and 12 volt power lines simultaneously, so we will need an external power source like a power plug, as well as the USB hub to connect it to our Raspberry Pi. Furthermore, if you choose 2.5 inch drives, you won't need to 3D print the 3.5 inch adapter, just the clip-in parts. Once that is out of the way and you have received your parts, the assembling process is quite straightforward. You can think of it as a Lego. I won't go into detail as to how to mount each piece, but I will be leaving the instructions for my specific rig in the description, or here on screen. You don't necessarily need to pick the vessel that I chose. There are a lot of NAS enclosures online that you can view, download, and print yourself. The end result will pretty much be the same in any scenario, so we can proceed to the next step. Setting up the NAS. First and foremost, we need to organize what are we going to use the storage for. In my case, I'm going to divide it like this. 4,700 gigabytes will go to back up my main computer's files. I've got a 4 terabyte HDD and a 500 gigabyte SSD, so I will give it a bit of extra wiggle room just in case. The plan is for the Raspberry Pi to wake up my computer at night, back up my files, and turn off the PC seamlessly. For this, I will use something called Wake on LAN and rsync. I will go in depth later on. 500 gigabytes will be for a second backup of my most important files. I'm not going to set up something like RAID 1, so if both my computers and the other 3 terabyte drive dies, I lose everything on them. It's unlikely that they would both die at the same time, but rather be safe than sorry. 300 gigabytes for backups of my Minecraft world. About 4 years ago, I set up a Minecraft server on Oracle Cloud's free tier that's been running on it ever since, even though I haven't played much on it in a while. In the past, I have tried to set up automatic backups to Google Drive via cron jobs, but without much success. So this time I will try something different so that I don't have to depend on third-party platforms. And finally, 400 gigabytes for a remote Linux desktop that I can access through my browser using Docker and Webtop, in which I will run light things like 24/7 scripts that require non-headless execution and thus can't run on platforms like Python Anywhere or Replit. I'm guessing this will be pretty handy for other stuff in the future too. So how do I actually do all of this? I'm going to need to install OpenMediaVault into my Raspberry Pi. It's a free, open-source NAS solution based on Debian Linux. Essentially, it lets me turn the device into a central hub for storing, managing, and sharing my files. First, I need to install the firmware for my Raspberry Pi with the help of the Raspberry Pi imager that will flash it onto my SD card. My Raspberry Pi won't be connected via Ethernet, so I need to set up a way to connect to it wirelessly with the help of this that will let me configure the network beforehand. Okay. This is me from the future. I ended up using an Ethernet cable as otherwise it wouldn't complete the OMV install. I found this issue after reflashing my SD card multiple times and corrupting it in the process. I will go more in depth later on, but let's continue. After all of this is set up, I can disconnect the SD card from my PC and put it into the Raspberry Pi. It should eventually boot up, enable SSH, and automatically connect to my Wi-Fi network. Now I need to find his IP address so that I can connect to it, so I will use the tool Nmap to scan my network for connected devices. Once I got it, I will connect to it using an SSH client. I will use PuTTY for this purpose as I'm using Windows. I wrote a custom password during the setup process, but if you didn't, make sure to change it immediately with the command password. Now that I am connected, I will update the system and then run the OMV installation script. It will take a while, but after it has finished, I can log into it via browser using the same IP I used for the SSH and the default credentials. I will of course change these immediately too. Once we've got OMV installed, it's time to set up the drives. I initially made the big mistake of just creating a regular ext4 file system for them. This made them incompatible with some of the tasks that I wanted to achieve, like backing up my 4TB drive, as it would overflow. My initial plan was to make it automatically continue the backup onto the next drive, but I quickly found out that wasn't worth the effort. I discovered that with LVM, I can merge them together, pooling the storage of the two drives into one larger unified space, which would leave me with a single 6TB drive. After they have been merged, I will still use ext4 as their file system, as it's the most reliable for my use. The next step is to create the shared folders. These are the virtual folders that OMV will manage and make available over the network. I will create one for each purpose and assign them an absolute path correspondingly. Once that is done, it should look like this. Afterwards, I need to make these folders actually accessible over the network so that my PC as well as other devices can see and use them. We'll do this using the SMBCIF service. I will have to enable this in services, as well as create them in the shares section. For each share that I create, I will assign it the corresponding shared folder I created earlier, as well as assigning it different permissions. This option lets the folder automatically appear on my network if turned on, so I will select it for conventionality. I will then leave the rest at their defaults. Now, once I click apply, the service will be running and the shared folders are configured to be accessible as network shares. Now that that's done, I need to set up my computer so that it wakes up at night to do the backup. I will enter my motherboard's BIOS and enable Wake on LAN. Each motherboard is different, so make sure to check the manual for yours. After taking note of my MAC address, which I will need for the script, I'll have to install some extra tools on the Raspberry Pi. I will save my Windows admin user credentials in a specific file so that they can be used to connect and perform the backup. I asked Gemini 2.5 Pro to write me a script file for this task. This script first attempts to wake my PC using a wake on LAN packet. After a waiting period and confirming the PC is online, it mounts the shared C and D drives from the PC onto the Raspberry Pi using the pre-configured credentials. It then utilizes rsync to perform the backups, first for the entire C and D drives, and then for a specific list of important folders from both drives, all to designated locations on my NAS. rsync efficiently transfers only new or modified files after the initial full backup, and also mirrors deletions from the source to keep the backup synchronized. Once all backup tasks are complete, the script unmounts the shares from the Raspberry Pi. Finally, it sends a remote command instructing it to shut down. I will then schedule it via OMV, as seen on screen. Once that is set up, we can focus on the VPS backups. As mentioned earlier, my use case scenario is for a Minecraft server, but I'd imagine this would work for any server with some slight tweaking. I will again ask Gemini 2.5 Pro to write me a script to connect to Oracle Cloud via SSH, compress the files, and then save them in the folder we assigned to it earlier. Furthermore, it will also rotate the backups once they get to the max capacity. What I mean by this is, if the folder reaches full storage, it will delete the oldest backups to free up space. For the desktop environment accessible via browser, we start by ensuring the Docker repo and the OpenMediaVault Compose plugin are installed, giving us access to the Compose tab in the Services area. I will create a file to deploy the Portainer container, which is our interface used to manage Docker. It's not 100% necessary, as you can technically manage it all through the command line, but it makes it easier. Within Portainer, we proceed to deploy the Webtop Docker container. It bundles a Linux desktop environment like XFCE. There is a lot of stuff to go over in here, but I'm no expert on it, so you're better off doing your own research on what each thing does. All of the scripts I showed you, as well as a step-by-step written guide and a list of parts, will be available in the GitHub repository in the description. You just have to modify the placeholder values. If you don't know how to do that, I have also made a few .bat files that will prompt you for these and automatically replace them accordingly to what you input. You might not want them exactly for what I used them, so even if I did most of the heavy lifting, just keep that in mind. A star in the repository would be appreciated too, as this video has taken a few months to make, and it's a free way to show your support. I would be lying if I said all of the process was simple. I ran into many issues while setting all of this up, so I tried to document the most notable ones and how I fixed them, in case anyone also runs into them. The first issue I encountered was that there were continuous chirp noises from the HDD and a seemingly infinite spin-up. The Raspberry Pi also didn't detect both drives when they were plugged in, but correctly detected one of them when only one was plugged in. This was due to using a third-party cable to connect the Raspberry Pi to a power plug. As mentioned earlier, the power that it can provide is extremely limited, and using an unknown cable only adds up to this problem. I fixed it by buying a cable specifically for the Raspberry Pi 4 that managed to give it the power that it needed. Another issue it suffered from was the Raspberry Pi not detecting the drives as drives, even though the command indicated they were connected. This was due to a compatibility issue with JMacron's adapters and the UAS protocol. The solution was to disable the problematic UAS driver for my specific USB adapters by adding this to the kernel command line. Another problem I ran into was when trying to run the backup main PC script, I was prompted with this error. This, as you might have guessed, is due to an issue with the drive permissions on my Windows PC. I fixed this by enabling administrative shares via the registry, modifying this and changing its value to 1. I didn't have it initially, so I had to create it manually. And last but not least, if you install a plugin in OMV and it doesn't work, try disabling the NTP server. This is not a joke. I wish it was. As mentioned, these were only some of all of the issues I have found on this journey. If you run into any other issues, feel free to leave a comment only after doing your own research online. I won't ensure you that I'll be able to help, but I will give it an honest try, and maybe another user that has run into that issue can be of help. I don't know how to do outros, so if you have watched until this far, thank you. Here is a list of all the music used throughout the video, and here is a video YouTube thinks you will like. If you don't see anything, that means you found this a bit too early, so just comment your thoughts about the video.